your nonprofit forward? You've come to the right place. Welcome to The Nonprofit Architect, where we are giving you the actionable steps you need to launch and grow your nonprofit organization. Now, here's your host, Travis Johnson.
Hey, welcome to the show. I'm here today with Debora and Wes Jones from the Multipurpose Room podcast. How are you both doing today?
We're great. How are you doing today, Travis?
Man, I'm doing fantastic. We're recording this on February 8th. It's my daughter's birthday. She is no longer, or I am no longer legally responsible for her. She's 18. She's out making her own terrible choices like I did when I was young. She's a senior in high school. We had a big, long talk yesterday. I got to give her her last hug as a kid and her first hug as an adult. That's pretty exciting stuff. But
that's awesome.
Other than that, not a lot going on. You know, just hanging out. It's cold across the U.S. mostly. What's new in your all's world? Anything good?
Well, we have been fortunate enough to have great weather this weekend. So it is not cold here and we've been able to get out and de-thaw and enjoy the weather. So that's been fantastic. And that's all really new in our world. We're in California, so things are still very much on lockdown. So we're not getting out much other than to enjoy that lovely weather.
Yeah, every now and then a house project or two, but that's about as exciting as it gets these days.
Well, I tell you, if you got Home Depot, Lowe's stock, or the people that supply Lowe's or Home Depot, you definitely made some money during COVID. I brought you on today because I want to talk about podcasting. It was so gracious to have me on your show, and I have just released the Ultimate Podcast Guide, and I really want to talk more with professionals about what it's like to podcast, why podcasting, how to repurpose this stuff, how to really sound professional. And then I want to talk about content creation and what that looks like. I'm a big believer that every nonprofit listening to this should have a podcast, either highlighting what you're doing or focusing on your mission, the thing that you're trying to save. So if you are doing a cat rescue, if you are helping veterans combat PTSD, if you're helping to fight against human trafficking, people should be able to hear your voice and know what's going on in your world. And that allows you to create the content you need each and every week to post throughout your social media so people know what the heck you're doing and why they should care about you. But why don't you guys start off with giving us a little behind the scenes and what you guys do with the Multipurpose Room podcast?
Sure. So we own an apparel company, K-12 Clothing, and we provide apparel to schools, K-12 schools, school uniforms, spirit wear, athletic uniforms. And what we noticed in doing that is that there was not a lot of audio content for our customers. And what I mean by our customers is PTAs, PTOs, teachers, school administrators. There weren't really any podcasts out there. There was not a lot of content providing practical tips to help them achieve their goals. And so we were already blogging. We were connecting with those customers through the business, but wanted to create another way to provide value to that group. And so we launched the Multipurpose Room podcast, which focuses on providing practical tips to the groups I just mentioned. And the goal was really to enable them to achieve their goals. And we do that through both our own advice, which we get by talking to other leaders in the space. We are also PTA parents, so through what we hear. But we also bring on guests who can speak to different things that matter to our audience, whether it's fundraising or how to present over Zoom, you know, a skill that teachers really had to hone over the last year that frankly they didn't have to hone before that, and all sorts of topics in between.
Yeah, I think it's a real opportunity to kind of engage with your audience in a format maybe that is familiar and acceptable to them. Not everybody wants to do video. Not everybody wants to just do blogs or articles. And we thought podcasting was a good medium where we could reach people and have conversations based on the experiences that we were having. And we thought it was engaging content to talk about, as well as, you know, I think from a business sense, it makes a lot of sense for every business to kind of either test in podcast or do some type of video or do some other type of format, because being an online business, you only have really two ways to reach your customers, right? It's either you have to pay to post or you're doing some type of outreach, whether it's social or direct outreach or so. And podcasting made a lot of sense. And I think it does for a lot of businesses.
Oh, I definitely believe that. And I agree with you. It is, it's something you use to build an audience. You know, I wouldn't have thought really that there needed to be, I'm not really in the PTA space. Me being active duty military, I've been gone for most of my kids' school career. But what a great way to reach a sector of people that maybe need some guidance, some help. You don't have to be in an organization like a PTA. And just because you've got new people come on board, you have to like reinvent the wheel. There's already corporate knowledge out there. There's already experience out there. There's already mentors out there that have been doing this or have seen this throughout the years. You don't have to just come up with it on your own. And I think so many people in that space and in the nonprofit space think they just have to make it up. Like between you and a couple of people in the room, like, hey, what should we do? And I don't think that that's needed. I think you can go and reach out and something like blogs or podcasting, like we're talking about, is a great medium to do that. I mean, I'm a big fan of the audio because I don't have time to take away from everything else and sit down and read. I've got 1,000 emails a day that I've got to sift through, or someone's got to sift through. I've got books on my reading list. I've got family obligations. I've got military duties. I've got the things I'm doing in the podcast world and for nonprofits. And like, also I have to take time away to read. That just doesn't work for me.
Yeah, absolutely. The great thing about a podcast is you can also like fast forward to the part you're interested in, right? Or you can listen to it at 1.5 speed while you're out going for a walk or while you're driving to the grocery store, right? Whatever little errand you're doing, you can just have that audio playing and it can be giving you ideas, adding value to your nonprofit world or your organizational world, where you're getting those nuggets, things that you can then use later, but you're not taking additional time out of your day to like sit down and read through something, to your point.
I also think there's kind of a golden era of radio that as our age has gone through, that people who are adults now, they've experienced. So there's something exciting about hearing your voice on the radio that I think a lot of us kids played with in the 80s when we were pressing record on our voices just to see what it sounded like. And now being adults and we can do that as a business, there's excitement about it.
Oh, absolutely. And more to your point, Debora, you know, I call it neck time, no extra time, you know, listening while you're working out, while you're commuting, while you're doing chores, or while you're running errands. Like no one in the grocery store gives a crap what you're listening to in your earphones, but to use that time, because grocery shopping takes what, like an hour to an hour and a half ish, no matter what you're there for, you get sucked in for at least an hour. Like my episodes, I don't know how long yours are on standard. My episodes average about 38 minutes. I've got some longer, some shorter. I've had some exciting guests on, but you can go in there and listen to an episode or two and really get ahead on what it is that you're working on, what you want to focus on. And if you're using this, you know, as a business tool, you're able to learn in your sector without taking away from the time and the people that you love.
Yeah, our episodes are typically 12 to 30 minutes. We found that the slightly shorter ones get good listening because they are those things that you can just fit in on your little errand run. And so we vary depending on the topic. We don't have a set target we are trying to hit, but we try and keep them under an hour. And certainly most are in that 12 to, you know, 30 minute range.
Yeah, and we actually really want to give value too. And that's why they're so short, is because we want to really hit those points up front and have an interesting conversation or give valuable next steps for schools to be able to move forward. So that's why we keep them really kind of short and ready to go.
Yeah, there's not really a school of thought on what the perfect length podcast is. I know the average time across all podcasts right now is about 62 minutes. In mine, I don't have a set time. If I've got a 9-minute guest with 9 minutes worth of content, I'm not going to make them go 30 minutes. And if I've got a guest that's got an hour, 20 minutes of content, like I've had some great ones like Patrick Kirby and Lori McNeil and just dropped amazing value in fundraising and how to connect with the media. I'm not going to cut them off at 30 minutes. Like, well, guys, it's time to go. You know, any range of this is great because you can do a 10 to 15 minute podcast, which is perfect for, you know, getting ready for work. You know, you're in there shaving, you've got the podcast playing, brush your teeth, do your hair. By the time you're ready for the day, that episode is done. You've started your day on the right step. The 38 minute range, right where I'm at, is great for a commute to or from work. for a lot of people. And then you've got people like Joe Rogan that their average is like an hour to 3 hours, and they do these marathon events. And some people really love that. But no matter what your style, your preferred length is, there is an audience that you're going to be able to reach based on their needs and what they're looking for.
Yeah, and a lot of the of our listeners are parents. So they're busy. They're doing things. They, you know, sometimes they do have time to listen, but there's definitely going to be something happening in the background, whether it's kids or dogs crashing around or something. So we really do kind of really try to target of something that you can use right away and implement within your PTA or your school.
You know, I'm part of a couple of different podcasting groups, and the question always comes up from people looking to start a podcast: how long should my episodes be? I mean, it's a very common question. And the answer is always, it depends. One, know your audience, right? To Wes's point, the parent audience might like shorter episodes, but know your audience and then stop when you have provided all the value from that particular guest or from yourself as the host for whatever topic, right? You don't need to add extraneous content. I'm also a judge for a podcast award series, and I've been listening recently to a number of podcasts, and there was one episode that was an hour and 42 minutes. And the reason it was an hour and 42 minutes is because the hosts were really enjoying themselves and sharing all sorts of inside jokes and stuff from when they were kids, which was fantastic for them. You could tell they were having a great time, but it didn't add to the subject matter of the episode. So for their listeners, that's the kind of thing that you can cut out when you actually release the episode, right? Because you didn't add that value. And so I really think the length of an episode does vary, but make sure that you are providing that value in all of that, all the minutes you're putting out there.
Yeah, I know for me, I hear criticisms like, oh, I don't really listen to podcasts. Like, you've got like a 10-minute intro, and then you have some banter. Then you have like 2 real minutes of content. And why should I listen to a 30-minute episode for 2 minutes worth of content? It's not worth my time. And one of the things that we provide, I really feel like your name is your core promise to your audience. So we try to give you the actionable steps and the how-to build your stronger nonprofit. And like today, we're specifically talking about podcasting and why that matters and what we're doing to start this and how it's going to help you build your organization, your business, your vision. And we want to get to the content right away. We're talking about different reasons why podcasting is the medium of the future, the medium of your choice. Like using that net time strategy, that no extra times, I went through 60 audiobooks, not 16, 60, 6-0 audiobooks in 2019, just commuting back and forth to work and listening while I was doing my exercise, riding bike or running.
That's impressive. That's a big number.
It's a huge number. And when you look out there, like the personal development world and the business world, they talk about these Fortune 500 CEOs reading on average 50 books a year. That's one book a week. And I don't have the time to take away from my family to do that, you know, visually, but I definitely have the time using my ears. I mean, one of the biggest things for me is that I can only do so much with where I'm at today. And if I'm not getting better each and every day, I can't provide that value. So I think maybe the biggest reason for me for podcasting is so valuable is for personal development. I get to bring in people like Wes and Debora and ask them all the cool insider questions on podcasting and learn something. And all of the guests that I talk to, I'm learning. I'm getting better. I'm getting stronger as the host. I don't have to pay for, you know, Wes and Debora's $2,000 masterclass and coaching stuff, which they may or may not have. I don't know. But I don't have to pay for that if I get them on the show and I can ask them the questions that I need for me to be successful. And, you know, if it also helps my audience, hey, why the heck not?
It is a great community. You do get to meet a lot of people and learn from others. And I've really enjoyed that aspect of it for sure.
One of the big things out there that I am a big fan of is creating content and repurposing things, because you create this thing like a podcast like we have going on right now. Wes, how do we take what we've created and use it for different things and other purposes?
The way we do it, we think about it strategically as we created this hour long or 30 minutes or 20 minutes, whatever piece of content. And for those who are not just audio listeners. We should put that in various places or various mediums. Some people are on Instagram. Some people are on Facebook. So what we do is we slice up that first podcast episode. Let's say we record a 10-minute podcast episode. We'll take somewhere between a 30-second to a 2-minute clip, and we'll actually put that on YouTube. But behind it, we put some type of visual as well. So it's not just the audio. So we'll use that as a YouTube. We'll also take either that same clip or a different clip, and we'll put it on our Instagram. We'll do the same thing with our Facebook. Typically on our Facebook, we actually put the entire episode on Facebook. So what we're doing is we're trying to set it up each episode, whether it's a splice or the full episode, and we're trying to match it to the platform that we're putting it on. And then we're trying to give our guests or our listeners the most engaging way for that platform to be able to check out either the clip or the full audio.
Then we also make sure that we give our guests the goodies from the episode so that they can do similar things with the episode. In other words, they get an embedded player so that they can share the episode on whatever medium they have available to them. Typically, it's their company's website plus their social media. We give them the episode assets in terms of the images from the episode. So those are the images that appear in whatever podcasting platform you use to listen to the episode. We give them links to the YouTube or anywhere else we've put the episode as well so that they can share that. And so that is the amplifier to the content that we're creating. You know, we give them the megaphone essentially and allow them to then share with their audience.
That is huge. And that's something I do for each and every guest. I've got a list. I send them a roll-up email that has links to all the content and all the promos, audiograms, clips. I can send them my LinkedIn link with the promos on it. I send them the Facebook link. I'm going to start putting more links on YouTube, little clips on YouTube. I send the YouTube and the Twitter and the Instagram and the Reddit and the Pinterest post. I send all that stuff. And I even send them a template sample email that they can use to send out the episode and say, hey, here's the clip. Here it is live. Hey, I got to be a guest on the Nonprofit Architect podcast. Check it out at this link. And then I also give them 4 little links where they could go rate and review the show as from being a guest standpoint. So I don't get everyone to go on a rate and review the show, but I give them the opportunity. So when I send them a follow-up email, they get all those pieces. I never thought about sending them the embedded player. What does that look like? How do you take that piece and send that to them?
So it depends on your platform. We host our podcast on Podbean. So on Podbean, when you go within the episode, anybody, not just us as admins, but if anybody goes to the episode itself, there's a share icon and you can click on share, and that way you can share on various social media sites. But you can also select embed and it gives you the code. So it gives you the HTML code. It's just iframe. And you can copy that code into your website and that will just embed the player right there.
Oh, that's cool. I'm on Libsyn, which is Liberated Syndication. And I just went on my site there and the same button is there that you can embed the player. I'm going to start including that in my email rollups. That's so cool. See, even an experienced podcaster like myself is learning stuff from the great Debora Jones today. That's awesome.
The nice thing about that is that it actually links back to your Lisbon statistics. So if they just placed a link, for example, to YouTube, that would go to your YouTube numbers. And depending on how you're looking at your statistics as a podcaster, if you're using your statistics for advertising, which is one way, if you're using your statistics to measure your company growth, whatever you're using those for, you may want your statistics all consolidated to one platform, for example, Lisbon or Podbean or whatever. And so when you do the embedded player, the nice thing is it counts towards your statistics there in Lisbon or Podbean or whatever you're using. And so statistics can be something very important. It can also be something that you ignore and don't look at, depending on your goals. But if your goals are to keep your statistics kind of clean and in one place, the embedded player is a nice way to do that.
Yeah, that is news to me. And I'm happy that I asked the question. That's so cool. I love to repurpose because I don't have, this kind of, you know, ties in with the content creation piece. I can take every single question and answer from every episode, and that's his own piece of content. I can pull, and I do pull, quotes that are inspirational or impactful from the episode. I put that on a little background. I throw that on Pinterest, or I throw that on my media channels. I don't have to quote unquote, you know, create content. I just have to pull the value out of the episode and share that with the fans. And when they go through and they're scrolling through the page, they're like, oh man, this is good. And they can get those little bite-sized clips that people love so much with Snapchat, TikTok, Instagram stories, reels, all that stuff. They can go through and get that little bite-sized snack and be like, you know what? This tastes pretty good. I'm going to go in for the full meal and check that out.
We're also building our SEO at the same time. It's something that we don't talk about. I mean, we talk about it on the back end, but for those who are new to podcasting and they're deciding if they're going to start splicing their content and sharing it out in different platforms, you should. I mean, you're absolutely building out your SEO. So if you have a website where you're trying to get people to learn more about your business or your services, that's all helping your Google ranking.
Yeah, that's absolutely true.
When we started this process, I think we were on page 4 of Google and we're now on page 2. Wes is giving me the hold on 1 second because I bet you he's going to Google it right now. And he will correct me if page 2 is wrong. But when you're putting out this content in written format in a number of different mediums and you're using those same words, newsflash.
Page 1.
When you're using those keywords there that people might use to search for you in Google, you are repeating them. Again, this kind of amplification megaphone concept. You're repeating these words on a number of different mediums, thereby improving your SEO. So when you're putting your podcast on YouTube, don't just put the overview of the episode on YouTube. Also do what's called timestamps on there, where you list out, it can either be by question or big topics that you hit in the podcast. You put the time that that topic starts and then, you know, a brief description of that topic. And when you're describing the topic, using some of those keywords that are important to your business or to your organization is critical to then improving the SEO. When you're sharing out on Medium or any other platform, just keep that in mind and make sure that those keywords are coming up, and then your podcast will go a long way to helping improve your SEO and thereby for people to find your organization and donate to your organization or participate in it.
Yeah, that's 100%. When we started doing that, we put in the little time hack and we put the keyword in there, the change of the topic or the question. And then when I put it on YouTube, I make sure that when I input manually the keywords that I'm using those time hacks. And this was another reason to start podcasting, because audio search is becoming a thing. Google will now take the audio and they will search through it to find you the right timestamp of a YouTube video. Have you guys seen this where you search for something and it pulls up a YouTube video for you and it has recommended starting it at like 2:13? That's exactly the topic you need. Have you seen this?
I have, and it's absolutely useful for sure.
If you want to have the real back end, because not a lot of people read the show notes, I try to add little freebies, little PDFs so people can download something, follow along, get extra value. But most people don't really look at the show notes. They don't have time, or they do it while they're commuting and they're like, I'm not going to be, you know, looking at the show notes while I'm driving and listening or whatever. But those definitely help rankings. If I put in right now, Nonprofit Architect Podcast, I'm about 28 of the first 30 results. In my website being number 1. If I put in Nonprofit Architect, I'm the vast majority of the first 2 pages, which is really cool. I guess we've been doing it right. I didn't know what I was doing, but I guess we've been doing it right if that's what you find when you search for me. What are some tips to make your show sound professional?
You know what? We were actually having this conversation before we started recording, and you were saying how you don't have the most professional equipment, but you get feedback that it sounds great. And I think that's a tip to anybody listening to this, is you don't have to have the biggest and the brightest and the best. We use a Rodecaster Pro system. It's around $500. It's not needed. If we wanted to do it another way, it makes it convenient. It makes it a lot easier for us to do some tweaking. But if you have nothing to start with, get a microphone, a Blue Yeti or something that can plug into your computer, get a set of headphones. And that's basically all you really need to get started.
And for the content of the episode, I think preparation is really critical. People undervalue preparation sometimes, but when you're bringing on a guest, I always like to tell the guest what we're trying to get out of the episode. What's that value? We talked about value earlier. What's the value that you want your listeners to get from that episode? Share that with your guest. Have an initial conversation with your guest to just get their perspective on the proposed topic. Create questions for your guest. It doesn't mean you're going to stick to those questions, but it gives them a chance to think through their perspective. And then in the episode itself, you can make it very conversational, but hit those value points and then make sure to summarize them at the end of the episode so that you are highlighting for your audience the value. The guest may say it one way, you say it another way. And when it's repeated, then it really sticks and resonates with your listeners. And then finally, I think the intro and outro being the same on every episode with the same music are those end caps to your episode, or I guess beginning and end caps to your episode, that really add that professional touch.
Yeah, absolutely agree on that. I know that when I recorded my episode with you all, you had a great summary at the end, and that was one of my wow factors. I'm like, Travis, you got to start doing this, because it really brought the episode together. It really reminds people what you've talked about, and it helps cement it in your memory. And then I do like the intro and outro thing. So other than the times that I've had ads, I don't want to have an ad and then add on with the intro and then the outro. Like in my view, and I don't know everything, but in my view, the intro covers your core promise to what you're going to be delivering in your episode. And your outro, in my opinion, and again, I don't know everything, should be the wrap up and call to action. What do you want your listeners to do? Do you want them to visit your website? Do you want to have them download you on YouTube? Do you want them to rate and review your show? Do you have a place you want to do that? What do you want them to do? What's your most desired action for your listeners? What do you want your audience to do? If you want them to go to your website so you can capture their email, then you better be sending them to your website. Debora, what is your kind of call to action at the end of your episodes?
It is focused on going to our website and, you know, just reaching out if they have anything that they want to hear more about. And so to your point, I think it can be really simple and it focuses on that call to action. Our intro and outro are both pretty short. Our intro, I believe, is about 34 seconds, including music. And then I think our outro is only about 10. So they're pretty short. And I think to make a great intro and outro, you really need to think about your show's mission. So for those people who are looking to start a podcast, the mission is where I would start. What are you trying to do here? What value are you trying to bring to your listeners? Who are your listeners? What is this mission, purpose, goal, whatever you want to call it, of your show? And when you start there, I think it's much easier to then create an intro and an outro that kind of support that. They're the pillars supporting that mission. And then it also makes it much easier to have a clear purpose for your episodes and what kind of guests you want. It's really your guiding light.
I definitely agree. I know I've been following some podcast threads on Facebook, things like Find a Guest, Be a Guest, and the Kristen Podcaster Collaboration. And they asked some great questions in there. And I got one this week was, what do you want for an intro and an outro? Like, who writes these things? And it's right in line with the exact things that we've said. What's your mission? Who are you trying to target? And your outro being your call to action and what you want them to do. It doesn't have to be complicated. It doesn't have to be fancy. One of the most creative ones I've seen for an intro was pulling clips from a few episodes talking about the host or what that looks like, and then splicing those together to kind of give a buildup to the authority of the podcast host. I've also been a guest where they have me shoot a promo for the podcast I was a guest of. So like, if I had you guys shoot a promo at the end of this, you'd be like, hey, this is Debora and Wes Jones, and we're on the Nonprofit Architect Podcast. Listen on whatever channel. Like, you can do that. You can ask your guests to do some fun things like that. And then you have extra pieces of content and extra things that you've recorded that are out there. I remember being a kid and my mom worked at a radio station, really only for a couple of months, but because I was a kid that had a nice squeaky voice, they had me record a couple of promos for KJJK 96.5 FM. And I think they played the best music, not music, music, because I was a cute squeaky kid, but that was in the 80s. That was forever ago.
Look, you were getting practice years and years ago. You're getting set up for all of this.
Yeah, that's definitely, that goes in my bio. Ran promos when I was 7 for Northern Minnesota radio station. That's perfectly in there. I didn't have the same voice quality as I do now, let me tell you.
That's awesome.
So do you, either of you, like, really put in a lot of, like, deep thought, a lot of strategery when it comes to planning these episodes? Or you just kind of map out a couple of high points and run through your show and try to hit them?
So we don't have an editorial calendar per se. In other words, you know, a lot of strategy behind what we're talking about every individual month. But I will say that we do try and order episodes logically. So I'll explain what that means, because I don't think anybody goes to try and order episodes illogically. So let me give you the definition of what logically means in our world. It's really paying attention to our audience, schools, and what's going on in schools at a given time. So in the fall, we're going to have more back to school relevant type content. Leading into the holidays, we will do a little more holiday relevant content. For example, a cookbook fundraiser around holiday recipes was something that we focused on in November instead of doing that in the spring, where it was a little out of context, right? In the spring, we'll do stuff around auctions. Then, you know, in the spring, we also do transitions because that's the time that our schools are transitioning, looking into the next year. So we try and stay connected with our audience and do things that matter to them at those given times. Relatedly, we search for guests who fit into those general categories. And that's how we prepare the year. We don't look 6 months in advance and say, okay, we need to target now somebody for 6 months in advance on this topic. It's a little closer in time. We're looking usually 4 to 6 weeks out. And then after we record, we may reorder the guests depending on what certain guests spoke about. Sometimes guests actually tee each other up without meaning to. And so we may reorder episodes after they've been recorded. So we don't necessarily record in the order that we will release. We release every Friday. So we have some flexibility to move people around a little bit. And then for the individual episodes, we do prepare quite a bit on the questions in terms of making sure that we are getting to those value points. Usually those value points are pulled from the conversations that we had with the guests in the first place. So they're things that the guests are really comfortable talking about. They're going to make the guests look good. And we do prepare to make sure that we weave in those topics in the episode. So I think that answers your question from a strategy all the way down to the kind of day-to-day execution.
Yeah, it absolutely does. And I'm a big fan of the pre-episode interview. I want to know who you are, what you want to talk about, why, where your expertise lies, how does it impact my audience? And to be honest, not everyone's a good fit for the show. There's a lot of people that'll contact me and they'll grab a slot or whatever. And sometimes they want to talk about nonprofit stuff that they're dealing with, or they want to be on the show. Like, my show is not generally a highlight show. My show is showing people some kind of how to do it better. And there's plenty of shows out there. If you want to be on a highlight show, that's just not really my show. And that's okay. There's nothing wrong with that. But there's also sometimes that we have to find, you know, and dig down to where the real value is. I connected with a guy, actually this time last year, Chris Starin, and we did an episode on improv comedy and how to use those techniques in the boardroom and then with your teams. But when I talked to the guy, initially, he's been a writer, producer, and director on two movies that were, you know, filmed for international release. He hosts his own podcast. He does Uber driving. He does a whole bunch of stuff. And I'm like, I was talking to him in my pre-interview for over an hour. I was like, well, what do you hope to talk to my audience about? And it took me a while to reel him in. He's like, oh, well, I do improv for business retreats. I'm like, oh, really? Well, tell me about that. What does that look like? And in the episode, when we finally recorded, we walked through three different type of improv techniques, and we did them in the episode. And if you haven't checked out that episode, go back and listen, because the first one I am absolutely terrible at. It's like I have never talked to another person in my whole life. It's hilarious. But the other two exercises we did were pretty funny. But anyway, if we didn't have that pre-interview, we would have been recording and it might have taken us a while to figure out what we were talking about. And that wouldn't have provided the right value to my guests. But because I'm digging for gold, you got to sift through a ton of dirt before you find that little nugget. Sometimes you got to do that pre-read to figure out what you're really going to talk about and making sure that that delivers on your core promise.
I totally agree. You find those hidden nuggets. You also get to know the style of your guest, which I think can be important. You know, we're all recording remotely here. And so cadence, knowing how breaks are going to work, so you're not speaking over each other, knowing if your guest is a humor person versus a very serious, like you don't want to crack jokes if you've got a guest that is very straight-faced serious and is just trying to get their point across because it may make them feel uncomfortable. And then the whole episode is just kind of thrown off. And so I think having that pre-call to make sure that there's a good fit, to make sure that you're on the same page of the value you're trying to provide, and then to find those more nuanced things, either the hidden nuggets or the personality, the ways to make the personalities work really well together, I think are really important parts of that pre-call.
I know for me, I want to make sure that not only they provide the right value to my audience, but they're also interesting, engaging, and provide a little bit of energy. There's nothing like getting, you know, Ben Stein on the episode and you've got this droll, nasally, no energy, monotone response. And that is, man, that is just not fun to listen to as someone checking out an episode or checking out a show. So not having that, you know, that really enthusiasm in the episode, that makes it hard to listen to.
One thing that Deb didn't mention that she's really good at, and you're talking about having engaging conversations, she goes back to questions. Like if you don't hit that question that she wanted to answer for the audience, she'll go back and kind of dig deeper in there and really get the audience, get the answers that she wants our audience to hear.
That's good. When I'm bringing on guests, I occasionally, not all the time, but occasionally will, if I've got a big name guest, like I had Alan Stein Jr. on the show, who is engaged and done work with Kobe Bryant, Kevin Durant, Steph Curry. I know, on a nonprofit show, right? Yeah, they still need leadership too. But I asked my followers, my social media audience, like, hey, I've got this guy coming on the show. What should we ask him? And I let them tell me what it is that they want to hear or they want to know about. If they want to hear about leadership and they also want my guest to tell me about the time that he went to a 4 a.m. practice with Kobe Bryant and he got there what he thought was early, but Kobe doesn't count the time spent warming up for the practice as the actual startup time of the practice. You know, if they want to ask questions about that, that's their opportunity to engage with the host and find out what it is that they want to know, whether it's legitimate value in my case in the nonprofit world, or if it's to find out one of those interesting factoids and human interest stories.
I think that's a great follow-up to your earlier point, which was more about reusing content when we were talking about, you know, how to reuse podcast content. Another use is pre-episode engagement, right? What do you want to hear about? Just general topics so that you can go source guests to speak on those general topics. Or it could be a specific question. We're doing an episode about teacher finance coming up. And we want to know, what do teachers want to know in this area? What's important to them? Because we will ask those questions. I mean, bottom line, yes, we are doing this podcast because there are some benefits for our business. However, the podcast will not be successful without a listener base. And our goal is to add value to that listener base. We want our listeners to walk away and say, huh, I'm going to do X, Y, Z, whatever, differently, or I'm going to try that, whatever the case may be. We want to add that value. And so hearing from the listeners, engaging them before an episode, I think is really critical.
It's added nothing but value to my show. I know that my listeners and the people in my network really appreciate that. I often get feedback. I ask for feedback all the time. I was like, give me feedback. If I'm terrible, if I put out a crappy episode, you all better tell me because I cannot make it better. If I'm going off course, if I'm missing the mark, if you guys don't come back and tell me. But I do a lot of work in finding the right guests. Where do you guys find your guests?
So many different places. I think the number one thing that is common to where I find my guests is me not being afraid to reach out to random strangers. I will send emails to somebody that I think will be good and they may not be good. We may have a conversation and it's not a fit, and that's okay. And everybody is on the same page about that. But most of the time we do find good people. So in terms of specifics, I go on LinkedIn. I look for people with certain titles around PTAs, around schools, and I reach out. I am part of a number of Facebook groups around podcasting. And although I don't put asks out in most of those, I look for people who are saying they want to be a guest, or just look for people who are doing podcasts of similar topics. And we connect to see if there's any crossover, any opportunities there. People I know, whether it's through PTAs or just parents I know, I reach out to, you know, people I went to high school with, people I went to college with, people I went to law school with, and I say, hey, are you part of the PTA? No. Okay, great. Do you know anybody who is part of the PTA? Do you know any teachers? Do you know any principals? Do you know any superintendents? And I just reach out to them. And then finally, the last category is other providers that are providing services in the K through 12 education space. So, I'll give the cookbook example again, actually. There's a company that does cookbooks. They do fundraising. They also do a number of other things in the cookbook world. They do family cookbooks, et cetera. But the fundraising element of it was particularly interesting to me as we were heading into the holidays, as we were doing a lot more cooking at home, as I saw other PTAs asking about cookbooks. And so I sought out a cookbook company and selected one that I thought would be a good fit and reached out to them and said, do you want to be on our show? I think that this could be good. Let's have a pre-call if you're interested. And you know, about half the time I get no response in some of those categories. The other half I get a response. And most of those work out to be a guest, but not all. Sometimes we don't have an overlapping goal. And so we have a great conversation and we wish each other the best and go on with our everyday lives.
I tell you what, that's so cool. And it really aligns with what we do and what I teach. I do most of my stuff on Facebook groups. I get into where my audience lives. I do the Nonprofit Architect podcast. So as you might imagine, I'm in nonprofit groups. Who would have known? I'm in these groups. I've got like 16,000 people. And sometimes I'll go in and I'll ask a question that I know needs answered and I'll follow up in like a private message. Like, hey, I'd be interested in learning more about what you do. Would you be interested in setting up a call? And I get great responses from that all the time. People are like, oh yeah, I'd love to talk about what I do. I don't know if they're thinking they're making a connection, if they're making a sale, or what they think is. And then sometimes they're like, well, you know, it's so much to get on my calendar, or it's like a consulting call. It's like, no. I host a podcast and I want to talk about your zone of genius, your area of expertise, your wow factor, what you do. Would you be interested in having me help promote what it is that you do? And they're like, yeah, I would like you to promote what I do. And you provide that value to the area that you are working in my case, nonprofits. And it's been fantastic. And then I go in there and be like, hey, who are my consultants and what do you specialize in? And boy, do consultants like to talk about themselves, which is wonderful. We've had so many fantastic consultants be guests on the show. And what a better way to help you both. You gain the knowledge, your audience to gain the knowledge, and for them to gain the exposure. You really have to traffic in that currency that really people care about, you know, helping promote what they do. And I use it as a great way to make connections and increase my network. There's going to be people that love what I do and they want to work with me, and that's phenomenal. And there's some people like, you know, that I'm not really the expert in this, but I tell you what, I know Debora and Wes Jones, and they are the people that can help you. And what a way to increase value in your world.
Yeah, totally agree. I've made some great connections through our guests, and you know, it's mutually beneficial, and we share about their business. They share about ours, and we get to have some great conversations that provide value to our listener base. So it's a win-win-win.
The rare triple win. I want to wrap things up today, and I know I wasn't planning on talking about this, but let's talk a little bit about monetization and what that looks like. Are you both monetizing your show?
We have a sponsor that we had an exclusive deal with. And so it was more about a mutual win-win rather than full monetization. But we are now exploring monetization. We have a media kit ready, but we are just waiting to have discussions with this sponsor to before we take the next steps. So technically the answer is yes, but in a limited way. We have looked at a lot of monetization. We have a really niche audience. So when you look at monetization, there's really two flavors to me. One, if you have a mass following and you have a really broad topic, you can do monetization directly through your hosting platform, typically, where they offer partners that have signed up with them and they offer payment based on how many listeners you have, roughly. There's specific details that differ by provider. So that's one way of doing it for us. That doesn't make sense because we have a more limited audience. Mm-hmm. We did that purposefully. So we're not going to hit those listening statistics that are needed for that type of monetization. So we focus more on mutually beneficial partnerships. So other people who are also targeting this niche audience, it makes sense for them from an advertising perspective and from a, again, content reuse perspective. So that is one thing that we offer to our current partner is the ability to reuse all of that content for their own blogs, for their own social media, for their own connection and engagement with their audience. And so that latter category is what we are playing in currently and what we intend to continue playing in, but we want to make sure that we keep ad spots limited. So that's a strategic decision by us. I don't think that that makes sense for every podcast, but we are going to limit it to just a couple of ad spots per episode.
Yeah, I know like traditional ads for podcasting is about $18 per 1,000 downloads on a 15-second intro spots or $25 per 1,000 downloads on a 60-second spot. What I found the best way to monetize for me is not ads in that sense, but ads for an event is a great way to do it, especially in a niche, because there's so many people that have things going on in that space. They're going to warrant different pricing. Like if this guy wanted to have an event and wanted me to promote the event and it made sense because it reached my audience, we could come to an agreement, not based on number of downloads, but how many weeks worth of promotion. And we've done that in the past. We're listening to this probably in July right now. I did 4 weeks of advertising for the nonprofit board summit for one of my former guests, Mark Bazan. That made sense. And it wasn't based on thousands of downloads, right? If I'm going to make $18 per 1,000 downloads and you've only got 4,000 downloads, well, then you've made just shy of $80 and that's not, you know, the best. But if you can sell it for $100 or $200 a week based on, you know, what your social media reaches, your email list, number of downloads, and the areas that you're going to promote their stuff, that can make sense. Another way that we've used to make a little side cash is selling swag, selling things like, you know, mugs, t-shirts, hats that had our logo on it. And if you're in the business world or in the nonprofit world, you can sell your specific services or your impact that you're doing if you're in the nonprofit. Maybe you're a nonprofit that has a membership group and you have to pay X dollars a month to be in the membership or be part of the nonprofit. You can promote that on each and every episode. If you're in the consulting space, you can promote your services. If you are like me, I put out that nonprofit architect ultimate podcast guide, and I've been selling that on my episodes and the course as well. That's I don't know, this is July. It may or may not be accredited right now, but we're getting it a run through college accreditation, which I think is cool. So you can take my course and actually get college credits or a certificate towards your goals, which is awesome. There's some people far beyond where maybe Wes and Debora and I are at. If you have some of these people like John Lee Dumas from Entrepreneurs on Fire, they're charging their guests because they're getting millions of downloads per episode. I'm not there yet. But I don't know what download numbers are for the Multipurpose Room podcast. Maybe you guys are there already.
No, we're not there. And, you know, we don't strive to be there either because this, the goal of our podcast is to add that extra value to our listeners to drive them to K-12 clothing, right? K-12 clothing is our business. Mm-hmm. The Multipurpose Room isn't. And so I think it really, you have to be clear about your goals for the podcast. If the podcast is a business for you as well, then certainly monetization and having goals on downloads and trying to really make sure you're achieving those goals, That is really important. If you are using your podcast to drive people elsewhere to your core business or to a different set of services, then you know, you may have a different goal there. So we have goals for our podcast, but they are much smaller than they would be if we were, if our, you know, pure end play was monetization of the podcast.
And even some of our guests have kind of naturally arose. Like one conversation we were having with the school, they were talking about Member Hub. And then a few weeks later, we actually had a conversation with Member Hub. So it was very organic in some of the partners and some of the guests that we've had on the show. So we're not really forcing it to go out and find people that could potentially pay to be in front of our audience. More or less is we're coming up naturally against these companies and these organizations that our schools are actually working with daily.
Yeah, I think that's important to understand is the reason you're starting. You can start this as a hobby. You can start this as a nonprofit. You can start this as a business. You can start it as a side project. But whatever the reason you start, understand your reasoning. Like I started this initially because I wanted to have impact in the nonprofit world while I was deployed to Bahrain. I was deployed to the Middle East. I was doing nonprofit work in the U.S. and I got over there and I'm like, how am I supposed to keep doing all this fun nonprofit stuff while I'm deployed? And someone's like, well, you've got the face for radio, so why don't you start a podcast and connect with people in the industry? Yeah, Wes just perked up. He heard the face for radio thing. and provide value to the nonprofit world. And what does that do? That allows me to, you know, create some authority in the space, to have some great conversations, to meet fantastic people. And my goals for doing it, my desires have changed throughout the time. And the podcast has changed and grown to me to where I want to be. And just because you start it in one facet today doesn't mean that's the way that you're always going to do things.
I think that's right. And I think it's important to reevaluate. I mean, we, as part of our business planning, you know, every year we sit down and have a strategic plan for the year. Last year, it was really about just starting a podcast. You know, this year we have very specific goals for the podcast, but as I said earlier, it's not about monetization for us. Next year, maybe that changes, right? And we reevaluate those strategies more frequently, but we change them annually based on how we've performed and what our other goals in the business are. And so I think it's important to, you know, use the wise words of Nike and just do it. And then you get some data under your belt and then you can figure out, okay, what's my next strategy? How is this strategy evolving? But come up with that mission, just do it, go forth and podcast, and then you can evolve it to, you know, whatever logical place is next, depending on how it's doing and how you as a podcaster are evolving.
I would also recommend that those thinking about starting a podcast, stay committed. So pick a number. So if you're going to do at least 10 episodes to see how it feels and see how it goes, or if you're going to, I would say even higher, maybe even like 25 to start with, because it's going to take you a while to find your voice. I mean, Deb is way more practiced than I am at it. And I find that, yeah, I look back on prior episodes and I feel like I'm growing just from getting used to speaking and the conversation and the organization of how the questions are written and developed, and just stay committed to it. So pick a number, I would say 25, go for it and don't be scared of your own voice.
I definitely agree with the 25. Right now, if you look out there, there is probably over a million podcasts that are abandoned and they stopped around episode 7. And here's the problem with that is, generally speaking, you suck as a podcaster through at least 10 episodes. So all 7 of your episodes are trash. I'm not accusing anyone. I'm not pointing anyone out. I'm not saying specifically this person is garbage. But I know when I go back to my earlier episodes as a host, I was awful. I was just no good. I fumbled. I stumbled. I mumbled. It was bad. And I didn't know what I was doing. I wasn't sure of the point. But to Wes's point, once you get over 10, over 15, and you're really dedicated to 25, you're in theory at least 25 weeks in doing a weekly show. If you're doing a bi-monthly show, if you're doing one every 2 weeks, that might be a whole year of your life that you've not dedicated to learning a trade, to becoming something more than yourself, and you're working towards a bigger goal. And if you're not sure the right price point, if you've got a cell phone and a pair of earphones, you can start your show. You spend all day talking to yourself anyway. You might as well record it and put it out there. Get started for free. I mean, we've covered a lot of stuff in this episode. We covered why you might want to start podcasting, whether it's for branding authority, personal development, using that no extra time, building an audience. We've talked about repurposing. See, this is that wrap up stuff that Debora taught me.
You know, I love it.
Your content, whether through, you know, Instagram, Facebook, using different clips, sending that embedded player in the email, using images, audio. We talked about SEO and time hacks. We've talked about sounding professional through editing, you know, creating value, being conversational, but still hitting the high points. We've talked about finding guests on LinkedIn. You can search by title. We've talked about using Facebook groups, talk to your audience directly, finding out what they want to know in advance and asking the guest what it is that they want to learn. And then we've borrowed from Nike. We say, if you want to start a podcast, just do it. Starting's the hardest part, and dedicate to at least 25 shows like Wes recommends.
I think that's right. I think people should get out there and do it and have fun with it and evolve yourself. And it can be a lot of fun. And so it can be scary at first, but overcome that fear and go forth and podcast.
On the fear note, there I've always thought about that. And there's a lot of people who that's kind of one of their questions of starting podcasts. Are you not scared of, you know, what you put out or how your voice sounds? And my answer to that all the time is you have control of what you put out. So that's the best thing. We were talking before we started recording of, you know, what happens if it goes bad? Like, you don't have to put it out. You can edit it however you want. Don't be dishonest, of course. Don't like reword things that aren't accurate in the episode that was happening. But you can decide if you want to put that piece of content out or how it's put out or how it's chopped out.
Yeah, pre-recording is fantastic if you get stuck with the mumbles or the ahs and the ums, or if you have a bad internet connection and it gets all grainy. You can say, hey, making myself a mental note, or you can tell your production team if you have one, hey, cut out that section. Or you can re-ask the guest, be like, hey, Debora, you sounded like you were pretty nasally or you were hacking and coughing. Can we re-answer that question? Sure, of course. And then you re-ask the question, and you take that part that sucked and you just get rid of it. It's no big deal. Or maybe you record an episode and you realize it doesn't meet your core promise and it's not delivering for your guests what you thought you would be delivering. And your audience is like, dude, this is so far off topic. Why do this? Or maybe you warn your guests, be like, hey, this is something that's not in line with our normal mission, but I had a great conversation. I wanted to share it with you anyway. That's perfectly okay, but you decide what you get to release or not. But just because you're nervous doesn't mean you shouldn't release anything. I didn't know what the heck I was doing when I started. And here I am, I don't know, probably almost 100 episodes in, and I'm having a great time doing it. I'm loving it. It's fun, and I get to meet amazing people like Wes and Debora.
We feel the same, and thanks so much for having us on your show, Travis. It was great, and we appreciated having you on ours, and I'm glad we got to continue the conversation today.
Thanks so much for being on the show today. We'll see you next week.
You've been listening to The Nonprofit Architect. To listen to all our past shows, visit http://nonprofitarchitect.org. And be sure to subscribe, rate, and review our show. Thank you.